us there. We spoke of was and when, although I wasn't there. He said I was his friend, which came as some surprise. I spoke into his eyes. I thought you'd die alone a long, long time ago. Oh no, not me. I never lost control. Your face to face with the man who sold.
Chapter 9. Andrew found himself in his second grade classroom. He formed a pair of legs with his index and middle fingers, and made them strut across the formica desktop toward the pair of legs dangling from it. His teacher was sitting on the edge of his desk, and he was fixated on her ass, hugged by an emerald green dress that matched her fair skin and blonde hair. He inched closer, unsure of what to do or what he felt. She caught him before he made contact, and his hand pulled back on instinct. The disapproving look would sit with him. She switched seats and gave him only one more glance before ignoring his presence in the classroom. A flattered smirk on her face confused him even further. Sex and shame were forever entwined for him. The daily beating of Catholicism through his high school days did not help. Sex was seen by him and his peers as both a secret and an achievement. A tall spilled blonde roast woke Andrew from his nap. It soaked his paperwork and his pant leg. He scrambled for more paper to stop the spread. The eye-opening aroma of a late afternoon coffee would soon turn to a stale funk. The clock read 5:07, and most people were packing up. Those who weren't had at least loosened their ties and let their hair down. Andrew knew their looks. He knew the power of their easy calls that gave them a sense of accomplishment. It was the rush they needed to go out for a drink or get on with their affair. They could ignore the hamster wheel easier and believe they were atoning for their sins by finding redemption in charity work. This lifestyle was far from generational, but the inability to be discreet could be partially credited for the divorce rate. Andrew had been there, and then got involved with someone who wanted to go there on her own. Following a predictable and avoidable end, he had isolation and insulation. Rain spat on him when he left the work tower. He finally answered the text from a woman which he had left on read 2 days prior. She was younger by nearly a decade, and had given him the upper hand. He invited her over despite his guilt. On their first meeting, he wowed her with a dance beside her car, and they kissed. She was younger, and he should have known better. He should have behaved better. Yet here he was, sliding an orange thong across her thighs and into his possession. She sat back, cutting off his oxygen. He enjoyed the rush. She insisted on some light choking, and he finally obliged. He nearly blacked out before she claimed to come, and he was unable to for another 10 minutes. He masturbated while he watched her and she watched him. "No judgment on how anyone gets off," she said. He appreciated her maturity until she was talking again about a date in the future. "I don't think we should worry about that," Andrew said. His words cut her short. She gulped and choked back the tears she was feeling. "So, you decided after we had sex twice that this wasn't for you?" She had him, and they had closure. Once her hairbrush and makeup were secured in her bag, he heard the elevator ding, and he fell asleep without issue. Bored with Tinder, Andrew called an old friend. He soon found himself barreling down a dark highway with only lust on his mind. His safety was secondary. They did not have to flirt much to know what was at stake. When she kissed him, they felt the years between them disappear. It was too easy to fall in love. "I can't believe you're here right now," she gushed. Andrew's heart was pounding. He dove between her legs and listened to her moan. He was gentler than their last encounter, but something visceral remained. She was still in marathon shape, and he puffed his chest to hide months of lethargy. He felt massive, wrapping his ill-defined, thick frame around her. He assumed the protector role she needed, and he could not fill. She was too good of a person for him. He could not take her eyes off her when they finished, as she draped her taut calves across his lap and sunk into the couch with a smile of content. Andrew admired her white nightgown, freckles, and her red, self-pedicured toes. Her eyes had a questioning way about them. Andrew could never gauge her intensity level, but he knew wide eyes weren't a good sign. Everything fell into place as it had 5 summers before. They felt the butterflies and unpacked their lives. "Everything on paper works against us, no matter how we feel," she shared. Their last encounter had been 4 years ago. She got pregnant soon after. Andrew heard about the abuse and how they were incompatible. The only thing bonding them was their daughter, whom Andrew had no interest in meeting. He saw where this was going, but he allowed it to continue. The wind was blowing through her thin brown hair as she took in the view, and Andrew saw her eyes working. He hated the assumption, but he knew she saw a good life with him. Raising a kid was out of the question. She hated the city. On paper, they were terrible together. In person, they could not keep their hands off of one another. It was the most dangerous kind of love he had ever felt. "How's the dating life?" she prodded. "It's all new again." She straddled him. Lying in bed in the middle of a Saturday afternoon was a luxury to her. "My mom wants to have you for dinner soon." He hated when she did that. Any response led to a regrettable conclusion for him. She slipped on a yellow dress. She was too thin for a floor length, so flowing at the knee was perfect. He kept his hand on her thigh while they drove through the backwoods of New Jersey, but she was cautious to perceive this as comfort. He pulled into the driveway of her mother's home to assert with his eyes that she would be making the journey there alone. "She's doing a whole Sunday gravy. Are you sure you don't want to join?" "No, I have a lot of work to do." She was used to his lying, and they continued their charade by keeping their interactions confined to Towers Residential. She stared from his window in wonderment. He imagined her thoughts of a better life for her daughter. On any other occasion, he would have dismissed it and pulled her naked body back into bed. Instead, he saw his life ending. When he blinked, Andrew found himself across from a woman begging for affection. He could not find it in himself. "I don't care if you're seeing anyone you know. I care about being respected. I'll keep 24 hours between you and everybody else." "Fuck you." "It was a joke." "Fuck you." She stormed off. He nearly fell asleep, texting paragraphs of apologies into the wee hours. It would have been better to have left it at that. Instead, they kept up the facade that the sex was worth the imminent crash. She sent him an offering from the kitchen. "I love you." There it was, hanging between them. "No matter what happens between us," she said. She left it up to him. Whenever their next angry fucking candlelit dinner arrived, Andrew decided to tell her the truth. He gnawed on a rack of lamb at her favorite bistro while mascara ran down her face. Andrew refilled her wine glass with an expensive Bordeaux. "Why would you even take me out? It's my birthday." Their waitress arrived with a pristine vanilla-frosted cupcake donning one lit candle. Andrew filled his glass and gave the waitress a dismissive glance. He paid the check and nibbled on the otherwise untouched cupcake. She carried a box of soggy mixed greens, sopping with the juices of the medium-well petite filet. "I never take this home," she said. He made her sick to her stomach and would live with the guilt. She won in the short term, but it hurt. "Thanks for dinner," she said. Andrew accepted his new persona. He had been in this city too long. Every restaurant sign, side street, and neon sign had a history of a woman tied to them. He funneled a greasy slice of Lorenzo's pizza into his face under a street lamp. He was there to feel the breeze and listen to the cars hum through the night on I-95. His talent for using people and maintaining the moral high ground infiltrated his life. He made everything too romantic too soon to numb this pain, and he cared little for those in his path. He recognized his recklessness enough to tamp it, but would never let it go. Under the glowing teal Penn's Landing light, he blinked at the younger woman who was new to the dating scene. They kissed, and he ignored her calls. He found power in it. Those flesh-filled moments were the bridge between two worlds. The parking lot below was another reminder of what brought him here. A red Honda CRX with a dumb extra wing glistened in the purple night. Spoiler, sure, that's what it was called. A bunch of machismo video game bullshit in Andrew's mind. He imagined it rocking. There she was, his former partner, blushing while her illicit lover was ready to explode. The new guy from work. How fucking cliche could it get? It was not the betrayal making him dwell. Instead, it was the obvious absence of love, thwarted by the cheating start of their own relationship. Now it was a tradition she was keeping at the end. She knew who he was and found it easier to break his heart than to tell him the truth. She would avoid and evade. Andrew opened his phone to the saved text he found when going through hers. Yesterday was a really hard day for me. The only thing I wanted to do was talk to you. I think that was the first day we haven't talked since we started talking. I have knots in my stomach thinking about this and how that's it for us. I don't feel like we talked about it much the other night, and I feel like we need to. I have so much going through my mind now, and it's killing me. If I should break up with him, or what would I say if I do it? How I pretty much fell for you, and that you are the guy I think about? Wanting to know how much you like me? Because then maybe that will help my decision? If I left, do you still want to be with me? What would it be like for us? This isn't or wasn't easy for me. There's so much I have to think about. If you'd ever give me more time. The one thing I think about is how good we can be together and what I feel when I'm with you. That we can be goofy and serious and just have fun no matter what. If I knew right now that it was you I wanted, would you wait for me? Not talking to you has me thinking a lot. I know it's only a day, but still, my brain won't stop. Maybe that's what will help me figure this out. Who knows? But I know I don't like not talking to you. I know this is my decision and I have to make, and I can easily change it. And if I do, I'm going to need to figure some things out first. Andrew remembered leaving her alone at Planned Parenthood to wait in the car. Being inside made him uncomfortable. He was watching the lives of the other couples fall apart around him while they pretended to laugh at the 40-year-old virgin. Who stocked this video library? These people were all younger and in much worse financial shape. Could they manage this? His friends had their own scares or knew a relative in the same jam, but they publicly voiced their disapproval of his ultimate decision when it had to be made. A humming vacuum in the distance brought him to freshman theology class and an indoctrinating pro-life video. If the hell they sold him was the truth, surely he would be there. It took about an hour. She fumbled with the lock to let herself into his cramped white Dodge Neon. They barely knew each other. His job was getting better and he could not justify a ring. With time, they made it work. When he found the text, it was a reminder they were bound only by death. His nights were spent working rooms and flirting. He saw more opportunity and he should have broken it off himself. Instead, he managed to convince himself that he could get anyone he wanted and yet found it morally superior to believe he was better off with her. It leveled him to discover she felt the same way. outsmarted by someone he had written off as simple. If she had not acted, he would have remained longer than either of them would have preferred. "You're always talking shit about my family," she said. Andrew looked at her and understood she was upset, but had come to loathe her and her family. "I tell the truth," he responded. "You're a mean person." It was innocent. He wanted to laugh, but her sincerity was clear. There was no cursing at him, no dragging up the past, and nothing false. She was right. He was mean. Then, someone doted on her at the office. Andrew began texting him back when he discovered the affair. He stopped and instead looked across the table at her sobbing face. He reflected on what he learned in the text. They were all there from beginning to end. The one where he broke up with her, the one with his home address, the one when she invited him into their home. His hatred for her was brimming. Every fight about marriage, children, the need for new appliances, his pot smoking, his attitude, all of it culminated into what he called her mistake. He would have to explain the whole thing if he did not. That meant holding himself accountable, which was impossible. She denied his offer to see a therapist until she was caught. He was willing to change and doubted himself for being so naive. He was holding it over her head whether she knew it or not. "The grammar in those texts was abysmal," he said. She sobbed as she had never grown accustomed to his callousness. "I feel sorry for you," she said. "You're just mean." The moonlit intersections on his walk to Towers Residential were filled with people buzzing since dawn, trying to sedate themselves to aid in sleeping and forget what they were waking up to in 6 hours. Some were begging, others were ignoring them. Most of his neighbors followed the same schedule. These people are vampires, soulless, motivated by dollars and cents, and now by likes and follows and shares and comments. They feasted in the evenings on foie gras and fried calamari. Nothing is made, only bought, sold, and illuminated. Andrew whispered into his phone to anyone who would listen. "They are mindless drones. Some of them have a better suit and a shoe shine, but who really gives a fuck? So here I am, locked in this castle, watching over this city that I love. How many times can the same view be inspiring? Maybe I understand the excess and how wasteful this is. I don't know. I don't sleep in my bed alone." Falling asleep could never break his stream of consciousness. Feeling tired frightened him. He eventually fulfilled all his desires and woke up next to whomever he had called. Blonde hair hid her face. Andrew sprung from the bed with the thought of having too many 5 more minute situations on most mornings. Besides, it would give her the chance to make her next move. He could do without breakfast or the conversation, but did not want to be rude. He let her know that he was heading to the pharmacy and put the onus of the next steps on her. If he found her upon his return, he would enjoy his scrambled eggs and make a play for another tryst. His ex's baby had arrived. He found out what he could from the old neighbors who would see her around. They did not respect him nor his frivolity. Social media platforms lent themselves to her forgiveness as their peers were more apt to sympathize with a baby bump than to his skyline images and champagne toasts. She was bringing new life into the world. He was so incredibly lonely and aloof. Legacy meant more than inconvenience. Her cheating ways were understood against Andrew's public displays of immaturity. Andrew stood in the greeting card aisle of CVS, listening to the sounds of Earth, Wind, and Fire. He was haunted by the conversation that followed her pre-procedure appointment. "Is it a boy?" he asked. "I didn't ask," she answered. He still did not know if it would have mattered, or if he was doing what he thought he was supposed to do. In that moment, he cared about his legacy, not her choice or potential struggle. He rid himself of any inconvenience. "It's not time," she said. She muttered it to herself on the way to the appointment. She vomited on the way back. "It's not time," she said again, through tears. Andrew kept his eyes on the road and his hands on the wheel. They made a mistake in creating something, so what was the point of staying together? In her new life, the father of her child was grinning ear to ear while they waited for the pregnancy test results. Andrew was primarily interested in fingering a secretary in a company-expensed hotel room. He watched his blonde one-night stand emerge from the revolving doors of his tower through the sidewalk window. She covered her eyes with wide black spectacles and checked both ways before scurrying down the street. Nothing gained, nothing lost. Metallic blue glitter designed to annoy covered the flimsy "Congratulations, it's a boy" card he chose. He stuffed 5 crisp $100 bills in the greeting card to prove a point he could never explain.
This affair would lead our love.